Today we have author and filmmaker Nicholas Kinsey in the studio with us. Nicholas has recently come out with a new historical fiction novel entitled An Absolute Secret. Hello, Nicholas.
Hello.
Can you tell us how you got started writing historical fiction?
Well, I started in the film business and as a screenwriter of movies and television drama. I've always been interested in good stories. What we call high-profile stories is the term we use in the industry. My first novel, Playing Rudolf Hess, told the incredible story of an imposter who ended up at the Nuremberg War Crimes trials. I'm a curious person, and I suppose I enjoy learning what happens behind the scenes. In the case of my new novel, An Absolute Secret, I stumbled across an amazing story about an MI6 intelligence operation run in neutral Sweden during World War II.
Wasn't Sweden at war at the time?
You may remember that Norway had been invaded by the Germans in 1940, and Sweden was next on the list of countries that Hitler might conquer. But eventually the Swedes were lucky and the Germans didn't invade. Sweden was one of the neutral countries along with Switzerland during the Second World War and benefited greatly from the war. In the case of Switzerland, for instance, they made a lot of money in banking and stuff like that. Sweden, on the other hand, was more mineral deposits and trade. Without Sweden's iron ore, Germany would never have been able to build all those weapons, tanks, and machinery necessary to wage war. So Sweden was quite pro-German during the early years of the war, allowing German troops to travel from Norway safely south through Sweden back to Germany. Of course, if the Swedish government had refused to trade with Germany, the Germans under Hitler would have simply invaded the country.
You mentioned intelligence operations?
Yeah, a lot of this is just coming out now after some 70 years. These stories were unknown to the public due to the Official Secrets Act in Britain, which prevented intelligence officers from publishing their memoirs for decades. You may remember the ex-MI5 agent Peter Wright and his Spycatcher book, which was banned in Britain in 1985 after its publication in Australia. The Thatcher government was not at all happy to wash their dirty laundry in public, so they attempted to ban the book worldwide.
Wasn't Peter Wright assigned the task of unmasking a Soviet mole in MI5, and he claimed that the mole was Roger Hollis?
Yes, that's true. The British government even tried to prevent its publication in Australia, which cost them a small fortune.
Can you tell me about some of the stories in your book?
Yeah. One of the most interesting scenes in my book was the meeting between Peter Fay, whose real name was Peter Falk, like the actor, and Anthony Blunt at the Reform Club in London in December 1943. Blunt worked for MI5 during the war, and it was only later revealed that he was a Soviet spy, part of the famous Cambridge Five, including Philby, MacLean, Burgess, Cairncross, and Blunt.
Wasn't Blunt a leading art historian and looked after the Queen's art collection until his arrest in the 1980s?
Yes, he was. He was a professor of art history at the University of London after the war and looked after the Royal Art Collection. He wrote a famous monograph about the French Baroque painter Nicolas Poussin. And he was knighted in 1956 by Queen Elizabeth, even though people were starting to suspect he had been a spy. He confessed, as I remember, in 1964, but it only became public when Margaret Thatcher revealed the information in 1979. For his confession, he was given full immunity from prosecution.
So Peter Fay met a Soviet mole, Anthony Blunt, at the Reform Club in the winter of 1943?
Yes, he did. You can imagine the desolate atmosphere of London in the winter of 1943. The war was going strong, and the city was a mass of rubble. The elegant Reform Club on Pall Mall was still standing, although a large swath of buildings in the area had been bombed. Why the Reform Club? Because Anthony Blunt was a member, and the old MI6 building at 54 Broadway was undergoing repairs after the bombing. So Peter Fay was very frustrated because no one was talking to him. He had to wait until December to finally be summoned to London to discuss the secret documents from the Karl Heinz Kramer operation in Stockholm, which were revealed in September of the same year. Kramer was a German spy working for the Abwehr, the German intelligence organization, who drove around Stockholm in a white DKW convertible and called himself Himmler's special representative. Kramer also had a suite of rooms at the Grand Hotel in Stockholm, where he would entertain the possible sources. The Gestapo in Stockholm suspected Kramer of leaking intelligence to Soviet sources and working for the British. He had a source named Josephine, who provided him with first-class information about British military matters. This source eventually turned out to be a Swedish naval officer who traveled regularly to Britain, and MI6 eventually put a stop to it. Bridget Pope, who worked with Fay at the British legation, had met an Austrian woman whose best friend worked in the Kramer household. The maid had told her friend that she hated the Kramers and wanted to murder them both. When Peter Fay met the woman, she told him about how Kramer took a bath every day at 6:45 p.m. and left his key to the study drawer on a table in the bedroom while he bathed for half an hour. So it wasn't very difficult for the Austrian maid to make a copy of the key and eventually to sneak the documents out of the drawer. The first batch of documents were photographed by Fay's people and sent on to London, where they created quite a stir within the intelligence services. One of the documents they discovered in the drawer was an original copy of the conversations between Roosevelt and Churchill at the August 1943 Quebec conference, along with a bunch of passports, copies of cabinet documents, and War Office minutes. It was an amazing haul.
So what happened at the meeting with Blunt?
Well, they met in the private room at the Reform Club, where Blunt advanced his theory that the memorandum was a German forgery. He suggested to Peter Fay that the wording sounded Germanic in its formulation, but Fay was having none of it. He had been present at the 1941 Atlantic Conference in Placentia Bay, Newfoundland, when Roosevelt and Churchill met on board a ship. The British staff at the conference had been shocked by Roosevelt's vulgar language in his conversations with Churchill. Fay believed that no one could mimic Roosevelt's obscene remarks about Stalin. And certainly no German intelligence officer could fake a conversation with this level of vulgarity. Clearly, Blunt was trying to minimize the importance of the stolen documents and may have been involved in seeing them leaked to Moscow in the first place.
So Fay flatly rejected Blunt's argument concerning the memorandum?
Yes, he did. He couldn't understand why Blunt was disregarding the implications of the hard evidence put before him. Clearly, someone was leaking extremely sensitive documents at the very highest level of the British government. It's hard to imagine a scene more incongruous than that meeting at the Reform Club when we know about Blunt's commitment to Moscow.
How did the documents get into the hands of Kramer in Stockholm?
It is believed that the memorandum had probably been sent first to the NKVD, or GRU, in Moscow, and then a double agent working for a foreign government had copied it on to the Japanese spymaster General Makoto Onodera in Stockholm, who then sold it to Karl-Heinz Kramer. Stockholm at the time was a bourse for foreign intelligence and German war booty, so there was a lot of trading and intelligence going on in the old city. General Onodera was the military attaché for Sweden and had numerous contacts in the Soviet Union and across the Baltic countries. He spoke Russian and made a fortune selling intelligence during the war.
Could the source of the memorandum been American or Canadian?
Yes, it's possible. All it would take was a communist sympathizer who was able to access the original documents at the conference and send them on to the Soviet Union.
Could it have been a German spy?
It's very unlikely that it was a German spy, because the document would have been sent to Berlin through the network in South America and would not have gone through Stockholm. A lot of the intelligence in Stockholm was Soviet, Polish, Hungarian, and Baltic in origin. Some of it came through Finnish intelligence. The Finns were extraordinary code breakers and could read everyone's communications, Soviet, American. They were way ahead of the UK's Bletchley Park operation.
What do you think of the security at the 1943 Quebec Conference?
My feeling is it was probably appallingly incompetent. That's just my feeling. The Quebec Conference was a huge public relations show, judging from the loads of pictures and newsreel footage in the American and Canadian press. Just take a look at some of the pictures of the military chiefs and diplomats and their wives 75 years ago. It's a bloody garden party. You wonder who was running the war while all these important people were enjoying themselves in Quebec City. If the Canadian government was organizing the event, then it was almost certain that the security was a joke. The Prime Minister at the time, Mackenzie King, was thrilled to be part of the strategy meetings and took immense pleasure in hosting the event. You can be sure that no feathers were ruffled by his security people. There's even a picture of one of the passes to the event with a number and no photograph on the ID card. Imagine today Justin Trudeau doing a Quebec conference with all the selfies, and that's probably the level of security you could expect from the King government in 1943.
Do you think that a Soviet spy could have penetrated the Citadel meeting rooms?
Anything is possible. The Soviets were extremely clever at getting any information they wanted. An example of this is the famous Maison Rouge meetings of German industrialists in Strasbourg a year later in 1944. This was a meeting organized by the SS to establish the Fourth Reich and to accumulate German assets in South America after the end of the war. The security was spectacular, with SS soldiers guarding the hotel and men on every floor and around the perimeter of the hotel. Somehow, a Soviet agent managed to listen in to the conversations between Himmler's people and the VIPs in their hotel rooms through finely drilled holes in the doors to the more expensive rooms. The Russians used information from this source at the Nuremberg trials a year later.
It's fascinating. Thank you, Nicholas. The book is entitled An Absolute Secret. And where can our listeners get one?
Yes, it's available as a paperback and also as an ebook on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and on all the sites.
Thank you.